Heaven's language is very different. Very different. So Elijah says, give me a job. Get in the job. Took it upstairs. To the upper room. See that? To the upper room. Put the child down. And he said to God, God, what happened here? Why do you do this? See, a friend of God talks to God. When you don't know how to be a friend of God, you dare not talk to God. You just accept. No, the child is dead. Let's just go bury him. No, he picked the child up and took up to the room. By the way, he took it up to the room. Took him up to the room. And you know what Elijah did? He lied on him. 3 times. Ooh, what happened, trees? Something big's gonna happen, right? The child resurrected. That was the first resurrection in the Bible. Hallelujah. And then he brought the child down. Here's your child. He's not dead. Let's trust in God. Let's trust in God. You think God will show you that to the woman? No, man. You curse yourself. You said, we will die. You didn't say we will live. Therefore, you don't get to see me. You don't get to see me. Every time Jesus, when he goes, like not, except for Lazarus, he would take the child and go up to the room and kick everybody out. Except for, sometimes he'll bring Peter in or James or John. But everybody out. Why? Because you're crying. You're not giving glory to God. You're crying, man. Oh, you cannot see. You're a different frequency. God's frequency is love. You are now talking about that. Close doors. Private meeting. Get up in Jesus' name. Child. Wake up. Wake up. Let's go down. Let's go down. Oh boy. The flower never ran out. After she gave food, the flower, the oil, went on for 2 years. Remember? 1 year on the river, eating from the ravens. 2 years eating from this woman. The jar of the flour and the oil never ran out. 2 years. God always provides the resources you need to do what He has called you to do. He never fails you. Right? So we have to be careful as Christians, not to put God in a box. You know, some Christians, they put God in a box. Oh no, you can't do this. You can't do it. I went to some theology class, they said, no. Don't put God in a box. Some of us have become so religious and legalistic, we end up putting God in a box called theology. Encounter shapes theology, not the other way around. Every miracle that happens tells us how big our God is. You know that? Just when you think all hope is gone, He'll show you a miracle. Just when you're sitting in Zarephath, there'll be a woman that comes with 1 ounce of flour on you and multiplied for what? 2 years, man. Just when you're sitting by the group of cherry, no food, no nothing, all of a sudden a black bird shows up and gives you meat and bread. Right? That is an encounter. Only when you trust God, you have an encounter. If you try to plan it on your own, that's your own plan. You come with your resources, it's going to end. Natural means instead of. Supernatural means your encounter with me. Okay? Through other Christians, through non-Christians, through people you know, people you don't know, through someone better means than you have, they're richer, or someone as poor as the widow in Zarephath with 1 ounce of flour left. He will provide you his resources. In his way, his time, to do his will, he will lead you. Now our job is to simply trust and stay faithful. That's our only job. That's why Jesus says, your only task is to believe. What are you going to do? Huh? Just like the Israelites, 40 years in the desert. What are you going to do? Are you going to grind up those rocks and pretend they are flour and cook them? Or fry the sand and try to eat them? No. You just have to believe. And then when he provides, remember to be thankful. Remember to be thankful always. Right? Ingredient number 5, lastly, okay, I know it's a long sermon, but you need to hear all this. God's guidance may include people who aren't just like you. Okay? You cannot expect everybody to be like you. If that's the case, demons would have won. They would have figured all of us out. That's why every one of us has a different anointing. Very different anointing. Elijah was called to the widow of Zarephath, man. I mean, there are widows in Israel, Judah, north is Israel, south Judah. There are widows everywhere. Why widows in Zarephath? Why? Into the heartland of Baalism. With no food to provide food. Wow. A Gentile about it. See, the reason for that is God's guidance just may lead you out of your comfort zone. He wants you to get out of your comfort zone to people who are not like you. Sometimes you say, my goodness, God, why do you surround me with these people, man? Like, why? Why do I go to church and I cannot belong? Why? Why? I'm going to run. The first time you run, I go to another church. I go to another church. Learn from Elijah. He didn't run from Jericho. He sat there for 1 year. He didn't go and say, oh, my goodness, what kind of widow are you? We have 1 ounce of flour. God, what are you doing? 1 ounce. Man, we have 2 more years. You say 3 years of drought. That means 2 more years. How am I going to survive? He didn't say that. What did he say? He said, hey, give me water. And then, by the way, you have 1 ounce? Oh yeah, feed me first. Wow! She says, no man, I only have so little. Me and my son only, one last meal, and then after that we're going to die. She goes, no man, you feed me first. Right? Then you watch the glory of God. That's how we have to walk. Sometimes God will lead you to a people of different color, financial status, educational level, culture, lifestyle, different values, even enemy land. Zarephath was enemy land where they worshiped Baal. There lives Jezebel, the priestess of Baal, with 450 of her false prophets, ready to kill them. You know, by the way, here's the thing. When God told Elijah, hey, go tell Ahab, okay, I'm going to release rain already, okay? It's 3 years now. Go, right? He walk, and then he met a prophet, Obadiah, go, man. He's going to kill you. You cannot go and tell him. He is after you. He wants to chop your head off. His wife is going to cut your, you know, why? Why are you going to tell? No, you cannot go. Elijah said, why? I cannot go. I'm just precious. Why I cannot go? It's because, you know, I'm keeping 100 of the Lord's prophet alive in the caves, man. You go, they're going to die. What faith? Obadiah. Elijah there. Get out of here. And Ahab said, oh, Ahab saw him, he said, oh, King Ahab, you troublemaker, you're back. You know what Elijah did? Oh no, man, you are the troublemaker for Israel. Because you did not worship our Lord God, and you started to worship Baal. You compromised. You put harmony over truth. Wow. King Ahab, who is this guy? With such authority, because he knows the Holy Spirit. Elijah is a special prophet, by the way. In the end, you know, he's the guy that in the flesh can actually be taken to heaven. Whew. Special prophet. And later on, you read that Jesus says, you have seen Elijah. Yeah. The disciples say, who? You have seen him? Who? John the Baptist? That's another day's sermon. I'm getting to that. Don't be surprised when his guidance includes going to people who aren't just like you. You know, when you're led to different places, you know, just thank God and be patient and know that he's going to show you only one step at a time. That he's going to provide everything. Right? And they, those people that he brought you to may be your Zarephath. It may be your crucible. Why? Because God wants to purify you. Yes, you're brought there to also, you know, God wants to work in you, through you, for them. But at the same time, he wants to work in you, to purify you. Until such time when you become pure gold, and when he opens up the doors, he's going to see his own reflection. The test. When God opens up that crucible, he sees himself when he's pure gold, and it's like a mirror. That's when he says, yes, welcome, well done, my faithful servant. Come, we celebrate together. That's what Jesus' words are. He said to the people with the bags of silver, they multiply. Because they're faithful. They're faithful to what he's given them. Faithful means you just trust him. If you don't trust him, you're still getting in. You're still in the crucible, man. Fire is still going on. You know, things are still not going well in your life, and things are really, you know, like, yeah, God, what's going on? What's going on? Well, God says, I want you to be like me. So when I open that, I see my own face in you. And on top of all this, you know, Elijah was a wanted man, right? He traveled 80, 90 miles into you know, this Zarephath was actually in the old days. Today is Syria. Whoa. Come on. Today I tell you to go to Syria, and you're freaking out. Elijah walked for 80 to 100 miles. But you know, in the scripture, Jesus says in Matthew 10, verse 16, he says, I'm sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Wow. What could possibly be more dangerous situation for a sheep than to be in the midst of wolves? And then Jesus goes on to tell the disciples, be wise as serpents and gentle as doves. He didn't tell them to avoid going because it may be dangerous. He says this, be wise as serpents and be gentle as doves. I want to read one more quotation from this guy named David Platt, the book Radical. He says, we think if it's dangerous, God must not be in it. If it's risky, it's unsafe. If it's costly, it must not be God's will. But what if these factors are actually the criteria by which we determine something is God's will? What if we began to look at the design of God as the most dangerous option before us? Woo! What if the center of God's will is in reality the most unsafe place for us to be? Wow. That shifted my thinking. I hope it shifts yours. And then in Matthew 10:26, it says, "Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul," Jesus says. "Rather fear him," his Father, "who can destroy both soul and body in hell." My goodness. So we fear God. Is there anyone else you can fear? Or should fear? No. You got God above everyone. Fear means you revere, you reverence God. He is God. That is your God. That is your Father. If your Father is so high, everybody else is so low, Baal is only here, man. You should fear him? No. The Father in heaven said that the earth shall be my son's footstool. Finish. Baal or no Baal, all 450 false prophets, all. Had to die. That was the deal. You cannot start a fire from your God. You die today. That's about dying in a very bad way. Dying in a very bad way. We'll go into that one day. Talk about Jezebel. Jesus is saying, don't worry. Or be afraid of people. The worst they could do is kill you. That's the worst. You should thank God for that. Hallelujah, you walk into glory. If you're doing His will and they kill you, you walk into glory. That's how all the disciples did it. When they were martyred, they give glory to God. Because see, they know where they're going. Do you know where you're going? You see? They know where they're going. And finally, Paul says in Philippians 1:21, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Remember that. Put that on yourself. "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Wow. You know, today, if you sense God is leading you, and you believe that the Word of God is true. You know, I was reading the Bible 2 days ago, and God said this to me. He showed me this. He says, if you believe in your heart that Jesus rose from the dead, that He conquered sin, that His righteousness is on us, we believe in our heart, and we confess with our mouth. When we confess with our mouth, Bible says your sins. When you believe in your heart, you're restored and redeemed. That's how you become a Christian. If you haven't done that, today I invite you to do that. To believe in your heart, first, in your heart, that Jesus rose from the dead. That means the worst thing Baal could do to you is kill you. But Jesus went there, got killed, and then rose up higher. And you're with Him. You know that. Nothing, no weapons formed shall prosper against you. Let me tell you something. The Bible says no weapons formed, past tense. That means weapons can form, but they cannot prosper against you. Amen? Why? Because Jesus is on the throne. So today, I just want to encourage you. Be ready. He wants to purify. Be thankful. He has chosen you. Be attentive. He will provide and equip you. Be open. He may lead you to places out of your comfort zone. Dangerous places, risky places. But notice, He goes before you. He goes with you. And He will never